Lamentations, chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. How lonely sits the city that once was full of people. How like a widow she has become, she that was great among the nations. She that was a princess among the provinces has become a vassal. She weeps bitterly in the night, with tears on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she has no one to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone into exile with suffering and hard servitude. She lives now among the nations and finds no resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her in the midst of her distress. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate. Her priests groan, her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters, her enemies prosper, because the Lord has made her suffer for the multitude of her transgressions. Her children have gone away, captives before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princes have become like stags that find no pasture. They fled without strength before the pursuer. Here ends the reading from Holy Scripture. May God bless our hearing and living of these words. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I have to say that I agree with Pat in that I really haven't heard a whole lot about Lamentations. It doesn't come up very often in our life together as a faith community. I think it only shows up in readings that we would do here in worship only three times in the Revised Common Lectionary, which is the lectionary that we follow. And even then, I mean, one of those times is the Saturday right before Easter, Holy Saturday. So we're usually not here. We don't hear that. And then even when it does appear, those other two times, we're often focused on the other scripture passages for that day. We don't read Lamentations. I know that when I was in Sunday school and we learned all the names of the books of the Bible, I thought it was Lamentations. Like when you're in school and your teacher's going to laminate something, like that was a very special thing. And I was just picturing like the Bible, and it was just regular paper except that section that was laminated. That's about all I knew because, like Pat said, we don't really come to it, and largely that's because it's not, again, like many of the passages that we've been covering this summer from the prophets, it's not easy, it's not joyful to read. It's sad. It's very, very sad. It's anguish. And in our lives we have a lot going on, and when we sit down with our Bibles, we want something that will seem to uplift. And oftentimes Lamentations doesn't seem to do that, which is a real shame. Because there is a tremendous amount of wisdom that we can gather from the book of Lamentations. So Lamentations, in essence, its substance, its content, is basically the name of the book. It's a book of lament. And really what the whole book is about is it's about the experience and the expression of suffering. In the Hebrew Bible, this book, Lamentations, is called Ekav, which means literally how. It's named Ekav because the first word of the first verse in the first poem in the book is how. How lonely sits the city. And I have to say that I think that it's a really fitting name, How, because I think it speaks to the deep sense of desperation that the poet must have felt when the pain was so great, when the suffering seemed to really overwhelm the world, and how that single word, it sort of becomes the only prayer that anyone can voice. How? God, how can this be? How could you let this happen? How? But whether you call this book Eka or Lamentation, it's a book of poetry. And all of the poems in this book, they were probably written soon after the destruction of the first temple in Jerusalem by the Babylonians, which really, it was an unprecedented event, followed then by the forced exile of many of the Judean people. Religious studies and Hebrew Bible professor Carlene Mandolfo writes, the poems seem to commemorate the experiences of those left behind, the people who were struggling to survive in the midst of this devastation. There are 5 chapters in Lamentations, and each chapter is a poem. The first 4 poems are actually acrostics, including the bit of the first poem that we read this morning. So in this case, these acrostic poems are based on the Hebrew alphabet. So the first letter of each verse begins with successive letters in the Hebrew alphabet. And so that format, that acrostic, it has a purpose. It's not just, oh, I feel like making an acrostic today. The purpose is that by using the alphabet like that, the poet is expressing the enormity, the totality of the destruction that their community was facing. It's like saying, basically, everything was destroyed. Everything, from A to B. That's the power of using that form. And that's the sort of symbolic meaningfulness that poetry can relay in a way that other types of writing just can't. That's why we turn to poetry when all other ways of communicating seem completely inadequate. Rita Dove writes, quote, poetry is language at its most distilled and most powerful, end quote. It's really either poetry or silence. Nothing else even comes close to expressing the magnitude of pain that this poet and their community was feeling. To be honest, it's really hard for me to grasp the severity of that suffering, of the suffering of the people of Judah. I just don't have anything in my own life that even comes close to approximating what this city must have felt. The destruction of the temple, it would have been beyond devastating. It would have been unthinkable. The ruination of the city, the capture and forced migration of its leaders, the collapse of this kingdom, the kingdom of Judah, this kingdom that is populated by the people of God. How? How could this be? The only thing I could think of that might even come close would be like the advent of blues music in the wake of the devastation of slavery, or the literature that comes out of people who have survived the Holocaust. This is the kind of mourning and working out of those feelings of complete and utter devastation that poetry and art can do that can't happen in any other way. But that's really very far removed from my own life, so it's tough. It's tough to get in there and try to get a sense of this without making it feel realistic or cheap somehow, to be honest. It's like trying to describe color when you have only ever seen in shades of gray. That's how I feel when I encounter this poem. I'm home. Because I know that when it comes to suffering, I know nothing. But this poem, it's in the biblical canon. It's here. It's in our Bibles. There's wisdom here. So, we read with humility. And we try our very best to see the colors. In this poem, the city is personified as a woman. In the first stanza, we get three examples of this. First, the city is described as empty, a place that once was full, now is barren. If we think about ancient cities, which generally had walls around them, we could see how the people of the city would be like the city's children, within the womb of their mother, or once they're born, within her shelter or her protective care. The second example that the poet gives us is the city personified as a widow. Not only has she lost her children, as a widow she has no legal protector, she's vulnerable, she's defenseless. Third, the poet tells us that the city had been like a princess. She enjoyed power and privilege, even dominion over neighboring cities. She commanded respect. Now there has been a staggering reversal of fortunes. The poet calls her a vassal, which is a person or a country that is subordinate to another. Sister Diane Bergant, professor of biblical studies at Catholic Theological Union in Chicago, she writes, quote, "This imagery suggests that she has been captured and is now a prisoner of war, one who owes homage and fealty to an overlord, and upon whom probably forced labor is imposed." And I would add that in the ancient world, and shamefully even today, women and girls in conflict zones are at great risk of wartime sexual violence. Combatants use sexual violence as a tactic to humiliate, dominate, and terrify people. And I think that the poet knows this as well. Jerusalem is personified as a woman, widowed, abandoned, and shamed. Verse 2 mentions her lovers. That could symbolize Judah's political allies who failed to come and support her. But it also hints that Jerusalem, by aligning herself with these other kingdoms, these other empires, taking lovers, air quotes, I guess you're not supposed to say air quotes when you actually do it, taking lovers, it's as if she's unfaithful to God. This metaphor is used frequently in many of the prophetic books. The writers often depict the people of Judah as a wife unfaithful to her husband, God. The logic sort of underpinning all of this is that all of the bad stuff that's happening, all of this tragedy and suffering, it was brought on by the people's unfaithfulness. God is seemingly justified in reacting through the violence of Babylon, just as a sworn husband would be justified in reacting violently to an adulterous wife. So we have to stop here, because this metaphor and the theology that it imparts is really dangerous. It's really harmful. And quite frankly, it's bad theology. Part of the problem with this metaphor is that it functions by making certain assumptions about abuse, and especially about violence against women. The mechanism at work in this metaphor, the logic that's at the base of it, is that intimate partner violence is legitimate. Domestic violence is legitimate under certain circumstances. It's okay. It may even be deserved. And that is a major problem, because that is not true. And I'm going to say it again. That is not true. Intimate partner violence is never okay. It's never deserved. Not only that, but by putting God in the position of an abusive husband, it lends righteousness, even sacredness, to that abuse, which is another form of abuse in and of itself. It's spiritual abuse now on top of physical abuse. And that is not okay. The person who wrote this poem was using a familiar metaphor to try to express the depth of the suffering that their community was experiencing. But the idea that God is vengeful, that God would kill people, would wipe out whole cities, would use the bodies of enemies to assault and violate civilians, that is not a theology that we proclaim. Because really what it is it's a projection of our basest selves. It's human violence projected onto God, and God does not work that way. God is not, and never has been, an abusive partner. When really bad things happen, when tragedies happen, wars, famines, pandemics, disease, or even personal tragedies, like a loved one who dies violently or unexpectedly, some people take comfort in believing that this was part of God's plan. And so if we follow this chain of thought, we can see the idea that this, in a way, it turns God into a monster. But at least that means that there's some kind of reason, right? You know, God might be a terrible, vengeful God, but at least that explains why all of this awful, awful, tragic stuff is happening. At least someone's in control. That's kind of the thread, the chain of thought. And it might seem like that's the theology, the understanding of God that's revealed in this poem. But really, that's not what this poem is saying. This poem from Lamentations actually is saying the opposite. It's saying that extreme suffering is never justified, and that the proper response, the only appropriate response to extreme suffering, is sorrow and action to stop the suffering. That's it. That's the only response. At first blush, it might seem like the poem is endorsing this idea of retributive justice, God punishing Judah for not upholding her part of the covenant. But when you read the poem in its entirety, and I recommend that you do, and then if you were to read through all five of the poems in Lamentations, what you discover is the opposite, it's the reverse. The idea in Lamentations is that the punishment, even if it's deserved, completely outweighs the sin. Adele Berlin, professor of biblical studies at the University of Maryland, writes, quote, "The immediacy of the disproportionate punishment, it drowns out everything else," end quote. Clearly, in this poem, the poet sees Jerusalem's torment as far beyond any punishment that may have been deserved. In the ancient world, just like today, when terrible things happen, people try to find reason. We try to comprehend the incomprehensible. When the unfathomable happened, what option was there but to groan and to scream at the heavens? in righteous rage and just to collapse and weep. And so in trying to process this total destruction, this chaos, this brutal traumatic experience, people try to explain it. A reversal so colossal, this tidal wave of violence that was so destructive, it must be God, they thought. Only God could wreak this much havoc. Today, we know that that is not true. God does not need to rain violence and destruction upon the earth. We humans do plenty of that exceptionally well all on our own. We require no help from God in the violent retribution department. The wars that took place in the ancient world, they really weren't substantively different from the wars that take place today. Most of the time, they were the result of disputes over resources and land, or of a government's desire to increase its influence and its power. And most of the time, in the ancient world and today, they leave whole populations traumatized for generations. It's true that there really doesn't seem to be a whole lot to smile about when we read this poem, when we read any poem from Lamentations. This poem is unequivocal in its despair. And yet, if there is hope here, I think that it's in the fact that these poems exist. They exist as a model for us, for when our city or our nation or our planet or even just life as we know it in our tiny little corner of the world faces destruction of unimaginable proportion, we can turn to these poems and see that that extreme suffering, it is never justified, and it is certainly not carried out by God. God is not an abusive spouse or an abusive parent. God does not bring about tragedies as punishment for sin. Any God who acted in that way would not be worthy to be God, because God is holy and vengeance never is. If there is truth in these poems, it is that the only response to extreme suffering should be weeping with those who weep and acting with tenderness to stop whatever is causing their pain. When a tragedy happens and we wonder, where is God? That's where. God is weeping, and God is tenderly seeking to stop whatever is causing pain. Amen.